Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to CEC Live Lecture. Dear friends, let's carry forward our series on coordination chemistry and let's learn something new today. So when it is a matter of learning something new, we would like to tell you all that today we are going to talk on one of the interesting topics. And today's topic of discussion is metal ions in biological system. Now you might be wondering what I'm talking about. Dear friends, to give answer to your query what I'm talking about, we have with us in our studios Dr. Navdeep Manav. Dr. Navdeep Manav is assistant professor in department of chemistry, Dyal Singh College, University of Delhi. Dr. Navdeep Manav has immense experience and she has contributed a lot in the area of academics, and her experience would definitely help us out in understanding today's topic in detail. After listening the lecture, if you feel so that you have any question, then you can call right in the studio. You are requested to call in the last 10 minutes of the lecture so that you could hear the entire lecture carefully and the lecture goes uninterrupted. And at the last 10 minutes, of course, you can ask your questions through our toll free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. So let's welcome our guest, Dr. Navneet Manav, and let's try to have a deep insight into today's topic. Hello, ma'am. Welcome to the lecture.
Thanks, Geetika. Good afternoon to all the viewers. Today we'll be discussing in the coordination chemistry module that we have started, today we'll be discussing metal ions in biological systems. In biological systems, metal ions, they play an important role, and there are two major important processes in the universe. We can say that life depends upon these two processes. One is the fixation of solar energy into chemical energy by photosynthesis. Green plants, they carry on photosynthesis because of the presence of a pigment chlorophyll in them, and by them they convert the solar energy and they fix carbon dioxide of the atmosphere and convert carbon dioxide and water to some organic compound like carbohydrates and water. So the solar, this is the only method of conversion of solar energy to chemical energy, that is the photosynthesis. And chlorophyll being the most important part of it, which is a metal ion containing enzyme, magnesium enzyme. And the second important process in life is, life processes, is the conversion of this carbohydrates to carbon dioxide and water and releasing energy in the body systems. That is respiration, that is the reverse of photosynthesis. So in photosynthesis, solar energy is converted to chemical energy. And in respiration, the chemical energy that is stored in the carbohydrates is released to perform various body functions. So to know, importantly to know what are the function of metal ions in biological systems, it's imperative to know about the cell structure. Basically, all living organisms are made up of the organ systems, which in turn are made up of various organs, and organs are made up of tissues, and tissues are made up of cells. So cells are the basic unit of life. So in this, the cell basically, there are two types of organism, prokaryotes and eukaryotes. And in case of eukaryotes, the most, except bacteria, these protozoa and bacteria, some of the bacteria, they have prokaryotic cell. But in this eukaryotic cell, the important thing is, firstly, the cell is, there is cell membrane, which contains the main two important parts in the cell membrane are cytoplasm, that is the liquid in this, and the nucleus. Nucleus is also bound by nuclear membrane. So, and the cell membrane is a semi-permeable membrane which allows the entry of only selective molecules to pass through it from one direction to another. So hence it helps in maintaining the osmotic pressure, and moreover it acts as a barrier for the movement of ions from one side to the another. So there is difference in the intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid, that is the molecules that are present inside the cell and molecules that are present outside the cell, they are different, and their concentration gradient that is maintained because of this semi-permeable membrane, and the osmotic pressure is maintained there. And then in the cell we are having various organelles, like in this we are having this nucleus which is surrounded by a nuclear membrane, and in the nucleus there is chromatin or chromosomes. These contain the DNA. DNA is deoxyribose nucleic acid, which is the genetic material which helps in transferring of the hereditary traits from one generation to another, and also helps in cell division. And then there is another on the nuclear membrane. This is the endoplasmic reticulum, which is of two types: smooth endoplasmic reticulum and rough endoplasmic reticulum. And in the rough endoplasmic reticulum there are ribosomes, which helps in the formation of RNA, ribonucleic acids. And these there are various organelles in the cell, like first of important is mitochondria. This mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. It helps in generation of energy by storing ATP in the mitochondria. And another important bodies are Golgi apparatuses, which help in, like, RNA, it synthesizes proteins, and it helps in messenger RNA, transfer RNA, they synthesize proteins. And in the Golgi bodies, these proteins, they are packed in various, you can say, in various packings, and they are transferred to the places wherever they are required. And in the Golgi bodies, there are special cells known as lysosomes also, which contain digestive enzymes. These digestive enzymes, because of these digestive enzymes, these are also known as suicidal bags, because these are used whenever there is a damaged cell which has to be dissolved. These digestive enzymes, they eat up the cell, they digest the cell. So all the various body organelles in the cell, they have various functions, and to perform all these functions, they are dependent upon metal ions in one way or the other. So we'll see what is the role of metal ions in all these body functions. So before starting functions of various cells, or how the metal complexes or coordination complexes are involved into this, let's see what is the role of metal ions. Metal ions, they play important role in large number of biological processes. In some of these processes, they require specific metal ions in the and also in the specific oxidation state. Like for some biological process, iron 2 is required, it will not take up iron 3, only iron 2 will be going that place. So no other cation or another metal ion can take its position. So these metal ions, they have certain catalytic or structural requirements there. They play either structural role or catalytic role. And in general, these metal ions, the metals, they exist as basically metal ions in the biological systems. And these metal ions, they are either bond to the proteins or to the enzymes, or they exist in the clusters which are bound to another cofactors like cobalamins and porphyrins. And the ligands that from the proteins or cobalamins which bound to these metal ions, they are basically oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur or carbon atoms present in these macromolecules. These metal ions, they generally, most of them, they play essential role in the enzymes, and almost one third of the enzymes, they have metal ions at their active sites. So the metal ions, they can modify electron flow in a substrate or enzyme, hence they control the reaction that are catalyzed by the enzyme. So they, when they control the reaction, how they control? They either bind to the surface substrate, or they bind to the functional group that is present in the active site. Sometimes they provide the site also for the redox activity. And without this proper metal ion, biochemical reaction, most of the biochemical reactions by the enzymes cannot be catalyzed, as metal ions play active role in these enzymes. And if in case it proceeds without the metal ions, then the reaction will be very slow. In our body, almost 2% of metals, we have only 2% of metals in our body, depending upon the body weight. But this 2% is the most of the body functions, they depend upon this 2% of the metal ions. And in the absence of these metal ions, there are various deficiency diseases that can be encountered in the absence of these metal ions. So the metal ions that are required for many critical functions, and their scarcity may lead to certain diseases like anemia, that results from iron deficiency. From zinc, if there is zinc deficiency, it may result in dwarfism, retardation in growth. And also, in case of copper deficiency, it may lead to heart diseases in infants. And also, the deficiency of copper also leads to anemia in certain cases. And the ability to understand function of metal ions at molecular level and to treat diseases caused by these deficiency of metal ions. So these are the two important aspects of medicinal bioinorganic chemistry. Bioinorganic chemistry is basically again the chemistry of biomolecules from the inorganic chemist's point of view. So far the biochemistry was studied from the organic chemistry point of view, biomolecules like proteins, lipids, fats that are made up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. They were the important biochemicals and the part of biochemistry. But 1960 onwards, the various inorganic elements were also found to be present in these in the body systems. And to understand the chemistry of these inorganic elements, it's imperative to study it from the inorganic chemist's point of view, how these metal ions, how they affect the various reactions, how they affect the various reactions in the body, how they affect the various processes in the body, and why their deficiency leads to various diseases, what happens with the excess of these metal ions in the body. So to understand this was also studied as separate branch of chemistry known as bioinorganic chemistry. So metal ions, they can induce toxicity also. Firstly, because of their deficiency, there can be diseases in the living beings because of the deficiency of these, but their excess can also cause certain diseases, and some of the metal ions, they induce toxicity in a way like mercury poison, lead poison, heavy metal poisons are quite known to these days to all the environmentalists. This is a burning topic these days because basically the generally the metals, whichever metal it is, if it is present in excess, then the required amount, it may cause toxicity. So there is a certain level of metals for the survival, then for the optimal use, and if it is in excess, it may lead to toxicity and it may prove fatal also if it is in excess to that. So to design various chelating agent to treat these toxicity, to understand the natural detoxification mechanisms, we must understand the metal ion chemistry inside the biological systems, because in the biological systems, the chemistry is different from the chemistry in the natural environments because of the pH of the body and various enzymes involved. Because when the reaction is catalyzed by enzymes, the catalytic activity of enzymes is manifold the activity of the catalysts that are being mimicked outside the living systems. So these are the major components of study in the bioinorganic chemistry. Now coming to the classification of elements according to their firstly occurrence in the biological system, they can be extracellular or intracellular. Extracellular means which are present outside the cell. Intracellular elements are the ones which are present inside the cytoplasm, like potassium, magnesium. Their concentration in the intracellular fluid is more than the outside. And similarly, like sodium, calcium, they are present more in the extracellular fluid than inside the cell. So it's important to maintain the concentration gradient for the survival of the cell. If this concentration gradient is not maintained, then the cell may burst. So then according to their biological actions in the body, these can be classified into essential elements, trace elements, non-essential elements and toxic elements. Essential elements are one, those are absolutely necessary for the life processes, and the processes, various processes may not function in the absence of these elements. And most importantly out of these are oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, the organic compounds you can say, or the non-metals, phosphorus also, then sodium, potassium, magnesium, chlorine, calcium and sulfur are also there. So these, some of these, they play the structural role, and some of these are required for other biological activities of the cell. And then there are trace elements present. Most of the transition elements, they are required in trace amounts in the body. Although they are required in the trace amounts, but their necessity or their importance cannot be ruled out, because in their absence, most of the body functions, they are hampered, or like they may result in various deficiency diseases in the absence of these transition metal ions like iodine, iron, copper, zinc, cobalt, molybdenum, etc. Then there are certain non-essential elements, like they are present in the body, but their function can be taken up by another elements in their absence, like aluminium, strontium, barium and tin. Then there are toxic elements which, when present in the biological systems, they will disturb the natural functions like cadmium, mercury, lead, etc. So these elements, when they are present in, like, if we look at the periodic table, we can find out from the periodic table that the ones which are in the square, like vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc, transition metal and silicon, boron, fluorine, these are the trace element but are essential for plants or animals. And the ones which are encircled by these rounds, they are the ones which are bulk materials that are required in larger quantities in the body. And the function of these, like arsenic, antimony, they may be present as trace elements, but their function is still unknown, and other ones are not essential. Now, the elements that are present in the body, they depend upon the geochemical abundance of these animals in the earth's crust or in the seawater also. As we know that the life has evolved from the earth's crust, then to sea, and then life was evolved. So these elements, they were taken up, the concentration of these elements, they can be compared to the concentration of these present in the seawater. But some of the metal ions which are present in abundance in nature, they may not be taken up by the body. Reason being, for the elements to be taken up by the body, these, because at the biological pH, around 7 pH, some of these elements, they exist as their insoluble oxides. Or sometimes what happens is, because there are barriers, there are membranes, so the to carry these elements inside the cells or inside the body systems, these membranes have to be crossed. For that, these elements, they need specific carriers or some complexing agents which may complex with these ions, and they may carry these ions to the inside the body, and maybe some specific complexing agents are not available, or these the specific carriers with which these may combine, they are not available. So these elements are not found in abundance, and most importantly, sometimes what happens is, like, if we see the heavy metals, the concentration of heavy metals in the earth's crust is very low, and so in the biological system also, the heavy metals, the concentration of heavy metal is not there. They are not found as essential or non-essential elements in the body. So although some of the elements like molybdenum, it's not very much abundant, but it exists as molybdate. Similarly, aluminium, silicon, titanium, zirconium, which are present in abundance, but they are not essential because they form their insoluble oxides. And if we look at the this concentration of iron, zinc, copper, molybdenum in the seawater and human plasma, we can see that their concentrations are comparable. And then the most of these elements, they are not toxic at the when they are encountered at the levels which occur generally in nature. But if their levels are quite high, they can be harmful. For example, iron. Although iron is found to be an essential element and is present in human systems, but if its concentration is increased, in United States it was found to be iron poisoning in United States in infants when they had the dietary supplement of iron sulfate, which in infants it increased the iron concentration and caused poisoning. So the all the well-known toxic elements which are currently of much concern in environmental problems, they are basically rare abundance in Earth's crust. Their concentration is low in Earth's crust, like arsenic, antimony, lead, cadmium and mercury. So for the if we see the graph, like in all the elements, this is the state of health, that is the optimum use of optimum concentration of the metals inside the body. If the concentration of these metals is lesser than this, it may result in the deficiency symptoms. But if it is decreased to about zero concentration, then survival is difficult. It may be fatal also. Similarly, if its concentration increases this level, that is, it may reach the toxic level. So depending upon the element, its interference in various body systems, it may have various toxic effects on the body. And if its concentration further exceeds, which is not being tolerated by body, it may lead to the death of the organism also. So basically, elements, the function of the elements in the body has different type of, we can say, functions, like charge carriers, sodium, potassium, chlorine. They act as charge carriers, like they help in carrying some molecules from one side to another, because they carry charge with them, and they also help in maintaining the concentration gradient or osmotic pressure of the cell. Secondly, structural or templating. Most important of this is calcium, zinc, silicon, sulfur, even phosphates are there. Phosphorus is there, which helps in the maintaining the structural part of the body, like bones, teeth, or major structural constituents. Then signaling. Signaling means it's like nerve conduction, carrying messages from one side to another. Calcium, boron, nitrogen, oxygen, and zinc are major in this. Buffering, phosphorus and carbon. And then most of the transition metal ions, along with zinc, they help in catalysis of various biochemical reactions occurring in the body. Then there are certain metal ions like iron, copper, molybdenum, which are having which can exist in variable oxidation states. The redox activities or electron transfer are taken place by these metal ions, and in some of the elements they help in storage of energy. Iron, sodium, potassium, phosphorus, sulfur are one of these, and another function of these is biomineralization, that is calcium, magnesium, iron, silicon, strontium, copper and phosphorus. They help in biomineralization of these various elements in the body. Then coming to metal ions in the biological systems, their excesses, their deficiencies, what is their role? So concentration of metal ions is controlled within very fine limits. The control is exercised by biological complexing agents, because the metal ions, they do not exist as ions, they exist generally in the combined forms. So the deficiency or excess of metal ions causes disorders which may lead to various diseases. So starting with calcium, which is the abundant element in a human body, metal ion, the healthy adult has around 1.05 kilogram calcium, and 99% of this is a part of the endoskeleton and exoskeleton. So this exists as phosphates in bones, teeth, enamels and hydroxypeptides like calcium phosphate hydroxide, and in exoskeleton of various sea creatures like shells, mussels, corals, sea urchins as calcite. Rest of it is in the cellular fluid, which either exists as ionized form or it is bound to the proteins, and it has various functions in the body like muscle contraction, enzyme regulation and signaling. So there are another hormones or complexing agent or various biomolecules that are required for the deposition of calcium or its mobilization in the body, like parathyroid hormone, vitamin D, calcitron, calciquestrone. That's why whenever there is calcium deficiency and calcium supplement is given, these biomolecules in one or the other form is given along with. Because in the absence of these biomolecules, this calcium will not be mobilized inside the body. So that's why this is like vitamin D is given along with the calcium tablets in the dietary supplements, or calcitron or calciferol is there. So the deficiency of this acts as calcium has important role in the skeletal or in the structural role. So the deficiency may lead to retarded structural growth, or it may lead to the porosity of bones also, bone density decreases, teeth gets weakened, and various body functions like which it carries like it acts as messenger. So the various body functions like muscle contraction, they are hampered. So in this also calcium ions, it acts as messenger by activating and regulating certain signals. It can take over the role of cofactor in hydrolysis, and it has structural function in various proteins. The malfunction of this metabolism of calcium, it may result in the insoluble or sparingly soluble calcium compounds like calcium oxalate, calcium phosphate, or calcium steroids in the blood vessels. So these calcium oxalate, calcium phosphate, or calcium steroids in the body, blood vessels, they result in various cardiovascular diseases because they will calcify the arteries. That is, the arteries will be thickened. Their calcification of arteries will take place, leading to various cardiovascular or heart diseases. When they are deposited in gallbladder, kidney, or like other secretion organs, they may lead to the formation of stones in these. So the stones, kidney stones, gallbladder stones, they are because of the excess of calcium present in the body, which is precipitated, which deposits as calcium oxalate, calcium steroid, or calcium phosphate. So calcium leads to hardening of arteries. It may lead to the formation of stones and also results in cataract of eyes when present in excess. Second element we will talk about is magnesium. It has also important role in both in plants and animals. Basically, the chlorophyll pigment that is responsible for photosynthesis, that is responsible for conversion of solar energy to chemical energy, which is the major source of energy in plants and you can say for whole of the food chain, because plants are the at the bottom of the food chain. So the chlorophyll is a magnesium porphyrin complex. So in the absence of chlorophyll, photosynthesis cannot take place. As a result, energy, solar energy, cannot be converted to chemical energy. So the magnesium plays an important role here, and all enzymatic reactions in living systems like oxidative phosphorylation, DNA transcription, RNA function, protein synthesis, and another critical cell membrane functions, they are dependent upon magnesium concentration, because these are catalyzed by ATP, and magnesium is a cofactor in ATPase enzyme. And the deficiency of magnesium may lead to the cramps in the body, because it also helps in muscle cramps in the body, because it also helps in muscle contraction. So this calcium and magnesium, after calcium and magnesium, will be taking up iron in the next module. Thanks for watching this. Thank you. starting with the iron. Iron is the most abundant transition metal in the biological systems. This is used by plants and animals equally. Also, bacteria also use this iron. But the role of this iron in some cases can be taken up by other metals, but most of these roles are unique to the iron. Only iron can take up this role. In the average human adult, there is almost 4 to 5 gram of iron. Out of this, 60 to 70% is present in the hemoglobin, in the red blood cells. Hemoglobins are the pigments which are responsible for carrying out oxygen from the lungs to the various body tissues. And rest is in the muscle myoglobin. Myoglobin is again in the muscles. It's a pigment which helps in storage of oxygen in the muscles. So the oxygen is transported by hemoglobin and stored by myoglobin in the muscles. So this carrying of oxygen from the lungs to the various body parts is the important function of hemoglobin and myoglobin, which are basically iron porphyrin complexes. So the iron is having vital role in the respiration. So in the absence of iron or in the deficiency of iron, when iron is bound to some other agents, iron is not available, that means hemoglobin will not be available. So this may result in the death of the cell also. So then another is present in iron cellulose proteins like ferritin, which is the storage protein of iron. Iron is stored in the body in the form of a protein known as ferritin, and it is transferred as iron transferrin in another protein, that is transferrin, which transfers iron from the places of its ingestion in it's digested in the stomach. From there, the iron is taken up by transferrin, which takes up it to the places where this iron is stored in the form of ferritin. So these are another proteins which are having this iron. And there are certain respiratory enzymes which are having iron, which are bound to some serum transport proteins there. Then iron deficiency may cause anemia, because red cells of blood, when they contain less hemoglobin, when there is iron deficiency, less hemoglobin will be there, resulting in anemia. And then if iron is present in excess, it may result in iron poisoning, leading to vomiting, shock. It may result in circulatory collapse also and coma. And the chronic condition of this is known as siderosis. In siderosis, iron is deposited in tissues and organs of the body. Now, in coming to this average iron distribution in the humans, if we see from this table, hemoglobin is having almost 65% composition of iron, amount of iron 2.6 gram, which is almost 65% of the total amount present in the body. And in hemoglobin, oxidation state of iron is 2. In myoglobin, again, it exists in the ferrous state, and this percentage is 6%. In transferrin, it exists in plus 3 in ferric state. In ferritin also, in plus 3 state, homocydrin, which is cell iron storage protein, it also exists in plus 3 oxidation state. And in various catalysis enzymes, it exists in plus 2 oxidation state. And for the electron transport in cytochrome C, it has, because it results in redox, it exists in both iron 2 and as well as iron 3. And thus in cytochrome, this is 0.1%. And in other enzymes, another rest of the iron is present in the form of oxidases or another enzymes in the body. So iron has specific roles in the biological system which cannot be taken up by another transition elements. These properties are because of its more biological suitability. Reason being, there is easy exchange of oxidation state between plus 2 and plus 3, and it has also the possibility of losing more electrons and getting converted to oxidation state plus 4 and plus 5. That makes it more versatile, more suitable biologically. And then it makes hexaaquacations easily in water. With water, it forms hexaaqua iron. And then it also helps, it also undergoes condensation and forms oligomers and polymers. So then there is most important factor in case of iron is, that is spin crossover. between high and low spin state of iron 2 and iron 3 when the change of ligand field strength is changed from higher field strength to lower field strength. They can easily get converted from low spin state to higher spin state, which we will study in the Peyer's mechanism in the hemoglobin. Then there is flexibility with respect to the number of donor atoms also and the nature of ligand functions that make it the most suitable biologically. So in the mammals, this is transported as transferrin and stored as ferritin. And this is basically both are proteins, and in these will be discussed in details when we will be discussing iron. Then this iron, how this is mobilized by in body? These are mobilized by some siderophores. Siderophores are basically the carriers which carries this iron from outside the body to inside the body. Because iron is exists as in nature, it exists as iron hydroxide, which is extremely less soluble. Its solubility is too low, and that's why in aqueous media this iron is not available. And for this, many organisms, they have to develop certain mechanisms to mobilize this iron inside the body. And these systems are these organisms, they excrete siderophores, and these siderophores, they take up the iron. Basically, these siderophores are the carriers which are having multi-dentate anionic ligands which form stable complexes with the iron. These stable complexes of iron, they are taken up inside the body, and there they are used, and functional group of these ligands in many cases are catecholates like hydroxyquinolates, or they are ferrodexamines or ferrichromes. So these complexes are more or less globular, and they have in their outer side they are having hydrophilic groups, and so that they may be transported, because when they have to be transported through the lipid layer, the cell membrane is basically made up of lipids. So the from lipid layer, this can be made in the hydrophilic outside sphere. This iron is ingested by, taken up by these siderophores, these hydrophilic outside, and this iron is dissolved inside, taken up inside. So this is basically, then it's with the help of this siderophore, this is taken up inside. This siderophore also reduces iron 3 to iron 2, which is then taken up by the cell. So this siderophore, after releasing iron, it is again released in the body. That's why in some cases, if we have seen, some bacteria are able to eat up even steel bridges, because of the presence of these siderophores in the bacteria, which they release, take up iron from the site and take iron inside, and that's why their presence of bacteria may erode very high steel bridges also. Then coming to molybdenum. The molybdenum is also an essential element in human beings as well as animals, because of its presence in the metalloenzyme xanthine oxidase and aldehyde oxidase. This basically, there is one nitrogenase enzyme which contains molybdenum in plants, which helps in fixation of atmospheric nitrogen to ammonia, which gets converted to soluble nitrogen compounds. So nitrogen of the atmosphere is fixed and gets converted to ammonia and then to soluble compounds, which will result in the formation of amines and various other nitrogen related compounds. So the nitrogen of the atmosphere is fixed only by these bacteria, which are dependent upon the nitrogenase enzyme, and molybdenum is the active site of the nitrogenase enzyme. So it is also the part of enzyme sulfite oxidase, because the inherited deficiency of which may cause some neurological disorders in the human beings, and it may also cause in early deaths in the humans if there is molybdenum deficiency in that enzyme sulfite oxidase. Then coming to chromium, role of chromium was not known early. The role of chromium as essential element is quite recent. This is basically found to be integral part of one organic complex, which is termed as glucose tolerance factor. So this glucose tolerance factor is basically helps in aiding in binding insulin to the sites of action. So it is found that in the absence of chromium, the diabetes 2 is dwelt. Diabetes is where the insulin is, there is excess of sugar in the body. So these activities which are like health, these also then in the absence, these glucose tolerance factor, in its absence, the another activities are also lowered, like lowering of serum cholesterol and triglycerides. So this contains this GTF, that is glucose tolerance factor, contains one chromium ion, two nicotinic acid molecules, and this may coordinate to three amino acid molecules like glycine, cysteine, and glutamic acid. And in the chromium, trivalent chromium is absorbed in the upper gastrointestinal tract, and this is the important, although this is required in very small amounts, and but the hexavalent chromium, which is more available in the environment, that is found to be more toxic, it is not absorbed. Only trivalent chromium is biologically active essential compound that is found in the biological systems. Then copper. Copper also is has a vital role in metalloenzymes, like various critical biochemical pathways such as superoxide dismutase. They help in metabolizing the potentially damaging superoxide anions, lysyl oxidase, which is required for cross-linking collagen and elastin, that is the protein connecting tissues. So the superoxide anion, that is a free radical, which is also harmful for the various functions. And then dopamine, beta hydroxylase, amine oxidase, tyrosinase, these are all copper containing enzyme, and these interconvert the major neurotransmitter dopamine, noradrenaline, and adrenaline in the brain. So they help in various brain functions, and the deficiency of copper, that's why it results in brain disorders also. So the tyrosinase enzymes, it helps in pigment production. Then cytochrome oxidase is the basically terminal enzyme and also the key enzyme of respiratory chain. It accounts for 90% of the energy that is required for muscle contraction. Then there is another enzyme, very important enzyme, that is ceruloplasmin, which contains copper. This ceruloplasmin is also known as ferrooxidase because it mobilizes and oxidizes iron from the storage sites. That's why found recently that in the absence of copper, deficiency of copper also leads to anemia. That is, if ceruloplasmin is not functioning properly, because it's a copper based enzyme, in the deficiency of copper, this ceruloplasmin will not function properly. As a result, iron will not be taken up after its ingestion, after its indigestion, if it's digestion, iron will not be taken up from its site to the other sites because of the non-functioning of ceruloplasmin. So in the deficiency of copper, anemia may occur because the dietary supplements of iron will not help in absorption of iron, which requires ceruloplasmin. So copper, it precipitates together with iron in the proteins, or it has a redox role also, because it exists in variable oxidation states, that of cuprous and cupric. So this also helps in reversible oxygen binding, its activation, electron transfer, and also dismutation. In some of the lower organism, this copper takes the place of iron in oxygen binding. Then coming to zinc. Zinc is the second most abundant transition metal of biological importance, although zinc is D10 configuration, but it is studied along with transition elements. Then in contrast to iron, copper, manganese, and molybdenum, zinc is not redox active. That means it can be used in the reactions, and it will not compete with the reactions for the electrons, because if it is exist in variable oxidation state, it may compete with the ongoing reactions also. That's why it makes the zinc more biologically suitable also. So zinc proteins generally they take over either a catalytic or structural function. So in the bloodstream, zinc is transported by albumin and transferrin. It is stored, its storage is achieved by thioins, and in the first zinc dependent enzyme, that is carbohydrase, was isolated in 1940 by Kaelin and Mann. Then in 1954, another enzyme that is carboxydase peptidase A was found in bovine pancreas. Then in 1985, the role of zinc in the genetic transcription as zinc fingers was established. This is the very important role of zinc in the biological systems. Here the zinc ions in the zinc fingers, they take up the role of transcription factors, which are necessary for the adoption of proper shape of the proteins, which allows it to interact with DNA. Although it's not still established what is the basic role of zinc, although it's found that zinc has more of the structural role in these proteins, but if it has other catalytic role, it has not been established as yet. So the zinc concentrations are also used in certain ways to regulate the gene expressions. And the deficiency of zinc, it produces growth retardation, dwarfism, testicular atrophy, skin lesions, poor appetite, loss of body hair, arthritis related health problems, and breakdown of immune systems, and loss of taste also. So this may result in because of impairment in absorption of zinc, not because of inadequate supply of zinc. This may be because of certain that zinc is not absorbed properly by the body. So there are various other mechanisms that are involved in the absorption of zinc from the dietary intakes into the body. Zinc is basically is known as a super acid or biocatalyst. It's essential element because it has certain properties which are specific to zinc only. If zinc, we compare the zinc to its similar atoms like nickel, cobalt, copper, iron, manganese, this is more abundant than similar atoms. That's why it is found in most of the enzymes, catalytic enzymes in the body, metalloenzymes. Then for an enzyme to have active metal site, it should have two properties. One, should it should make better complex, its complexing nature should be better. It forms strong complexes as compared to manganese ions and iron ions. That's why it is preferred. Moreover, for an enzyme to act as catalyst, it should be easily labile. Labile means it's a substitution at this should take place easily. So in case of zinc, it is found that in case of zinc compounds, they are more labile than magnesium and nickel. So that's why it's preferred at the catalytic sites. And then it does not undergo redox reaction, so it will not compete with the ongoing electron transfers in the biochemical processes. Then it has flexible coordination geometry than another cations of similar nature like nickel and magnesium. That's why it's found in most of the metalloenzymes, or it is known as super acid for the biocatalyst. Then coming to cobalt. Cobalt has an important role in biochemical metalloenzyme reactions, like it exists as cobalamin. Cobalamin is vitamin B12, commonly known as vitamin B12. It's a soluble vitamin which has important role in the nervous system and functioning of brain, and it's for the formation of blood. With this element, cobalt is must. So this vitamin B12 is one of the 8 B vitamins, and it's involved in the metabolism of every cell of human body. Especially it will affect the DNA synthesis and regulation, but it also helps in fatty acid synthesis and energy production. So the vitamin B12 deficiency may cause disease known as pernicious anemia. This pernicious anemia is an autoimmune disease in which the parietal cells of stomach, which generally help in secreting intrinsic factors, are destroyed. This intrinsic factor is responsible for absorption of cobalamin. So it results in vicious cycle which results in the anemia. So in pernicious anemia, the body is not able to make enough of the red blood cells. So there is deficiency of red blood cells or anemia inside the body. Hemoglobin is lesser. What are the uses of vitamin B12? This can be used for making up the deficiency of vitamin B12 in the body, or it can help in cyanide poisoning. This has heredity, or wherever there is deficiency of transcobalamin 2, hereditary deficiency, there when the supplements of vitamin B12 are given, they may help in curing this. This is also maybe like required for the brain atrophy, shrinkage that is associated with Alzheimer's disease and impaired cognitive effect. So if it helps in these functions, it may help in protecting the human beings against these diseases like Alzheimer's disease, brain atrophy, or certain other impaired functions of the brain. Then the deficiency of these elements, if we sum up the deficiency of these elements in the body, calcium, deficiency of calcium results in retarded skeletal growth, or it may result in weakening of bones also, most of the osteoporosis is when the bone density is low. This is because of the deficiency of calcium, or in like in menopausal women or after a certain age, the calcium is less absorbed in the body, which results in the osteoporosis. Then magnesium is deficiency of magnesium results in muscle cramps. It's present in quite abundance in the body, so its deficiency is only found in muscle cramps. Then iron results in anemia. Deficiency in immune disorders are there, certain immunodeficient orders are there. Then zinc, it results in dwarfism, skin lesions. Then maturation is not achieved by the human beings. Then copper deficiency leads to liver disorders, secondary anemia. And manganese results in infertility, impaired skeletal growth. From the molybdenum, retarded cellular growth will be there. Deficiency of cobalt results in pernicious anemia. And deficiency of nickel may cause depressed growth, dermatitis, and chromium will result in diabetic symptoms, and silicon will result in skeletal growth disorders, and fluoride, deficiency of fluoride will result in dental disorder, and iodine is known in goiter functioning, so it will result in thyroid hormone disorders. Selenium in cardiac muscular weakness, and arsenic for impaired growth. Although the functions of selenium and arsenic in biochemical functions in biological systems is still not known to us, but their deficiency is found to have certain effects on the human beings, although not that proved. Now coming to toxicity of these elements, any element which is present, then required amount may be toxic. So, if it is present, then the required excess of like anything can be poison. So, similarly, excess of the elements in the body may result in the toxicity. Although the toxicity of these mechanism of toxicity is still complicated, but they can have reasons can be varied from like blockening of enzyme. Firstly, the most of the metal ions, how they become toxic is they interfere in the biological functions. Because biological functions are basically carried out by biomolecules or enzymes, and generally a metal ion is at the active site of these enzymes, and these toxic metal ions may substitute those metal ions that are present as the active sites of the enzymes, such as amino acid residues like serine, where we are having OH functional group, or cysteine where SH group is there, or histidine where there is nitrogen group, And when they take up bind with the active sites of the enzymes, they may block the activity of these enzymes. So either they will bind with the active sites of the enzyme or they will substitute the metal ion from the biomolecule. So when the metal ion from the biomolecule is substituted by another foreign metal ion, it may lose its activity. So the biomolecules, they have certain active transformations, and when there is coordination of the toxic metal ions with these biomolecules, their active conformations may be lost. And upon losing the active conformations, these biomolecules may lose their activity. So if the biomolecules or enzymes, they lose their activity, they do not function properly because of the presence of these toxic enzymes which block their activity, which block their active sites or which change their conformation, this may result in hampering the various biological functions. The function, the enzyme which they are inhibiting or the enzyme which they are blocking, that will result in which body function they will be disturbing or which organ these toxic metal ions will be affecting. So starting with mercury, mercury actually basically toxic effect of these metal ions were found to be came to limelight by the incidence of Minamata disease in 1953 to 1960 in Japan. In Japan, it was found that more than 111 cases of people, they took the fish from the sea of Bay of Minamata. And then because this was located on some industrial site which released inorganic mercury into the bay. So this Minamata disease was taken up, this Minamata disease was caused because of mercury poisoning, and out of this 111, 45 deaths were reported. And it was later on found that the sea fish contained almost 27 to 102 ppm of mercury in the form of methyl mercury. Although this mercury was released as inorganic mercury in the sea, but because of the presence of certain fishes over there, it was converted to methyl mercury, which reached the brain of the ones who were affected by eating this, and this was this caused the death of most of those who ate in this fish. And then another tragic incident was reported of mercury poisoning in Iraq. That was in 1972. There 450 villagers died because of eating this wheat, which was on which this pesticide of mercury was sprayed. And this mercury, it can be toxic by ingestion or inhalation, but the toxicity depends upon the chemical form on which it is. Soluble inorganic mercury salts are basically highly toxic. They cause erosion of intestinal tracts, kidney failures, and sometimes in untimely deaths. Because of paucity of time, we will continue this toxicity of aliments in the next lecture. Thanks for watching this.
Thank you so very much. Today we had a vivacious session, and dear friends, as Dr. Navdeep Manav herself said, that we would be continuing from where we left today and would be discussing further. So dear friends, if you have learned and after learning you feel so that there are certain questions to be answer, then do write to us at info.cec@nic.in. You can post your questions as well as your feedbacks and suggestions. We would be meeting again soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much.